So you see the, this interesting case. So I think you acknowledge that the difficulty is going a little bit up.
yes.
So it's a long lesion. There is more calcification than the previous case. So the first question is it a bifurcation? And I show you this view here. And I think that a good reflection, a good view to see that it's really a bifurcation. So it's a high bifurcation of the right. And I think we all agree that we don't want to lose any of those two branches. Do you agree?
Yes, we agree, yes, Thomas.
Okay.
So we agree that it's a complex case. You need good support.
Yeah.
You have used the Amplatz.
Yeah. So the my choice for this case. So the setting is the same. We are in a right radial approach again in six French, which is mandatory for any bifurcation. At least six French. And the choice for the guiding catheter was for sure not a GR because the support will be too poor, and it will make the procedure even more difficult. So Amplatz, which can be 0.75, or in this case, Amplatz 1, or the 3D right is also a good option, but it will need a little bit more participation of the operator to increase the support by making clockwise maneuver each time you want to increase the support, and with the Amplatz you don't have to do that all the time. So I think that for me it's for a difficult case like this it's the best choice. So it was a little bit of struggling to go through this first lesion. You see.
So do you hear me now?
This is the calcified lesion. What's your? Can you tell us something about the patient and strategy of your patient?
So it was a 65 years old gentleman with angina pectoris, he has also a lesion on the mid circumflex. But we will focus today only on the right lesion. We can discuss now about the strategy of this angioplasty together.
Okay. So this is the calcified lesion?
Yes.
Short calcified lesion. Can I ask the panelists what your decision, Ahmed Naguib?
I start with the redilatation by NC balloon, calcified lesion. And then if fully opposed, I would start to stand. If fully opposed.
The second question, if you have IBUS or OCT in your core lab, what's imaging procedure? Is Ayman?
Okay, I think if, for this case, if you have OCT, the optimal, if you have all the equipment in the cath lab, the optimal approach would be to cross with the wire, look at it with OCT, and determine the three criteria that Dr. Thierry Lefebvre mentioned, which is the calcium thickness, the length of the lesion, the calcium, and the arc of the calcium. If it is a low risk, then you can just pre-dilate and put the stent. If it has all three criteria, then it would be better to probably go with rotablator or perhaps IVL.
If so you don't have a very interesting course, sorry, Thomas, ask the panelists as well. Because in Egypt, not in each country, in each core lab, we don't have IBUS or OCT. Particularly OCT is not available. We have IBUS, but
yes.
Not OCT. So are you doing IBUS before or after doing a debulking of the calcified lesions, Dr. Ahmed Sayed?
So in this case, I think it will be illusory to be able to cross this calcified lesion without predilatation with IVLs or even with the OCT. And more than that, I think that before doing OCT and or IVLs, you must choose the strategy. Because if you start predilating one of those two branches or both of them, it means that you want to stent them. So as you will need for sure predilatation for IVUS or OCT, you have to think twice before doing predilatation because if we can talk together about the strategy, but
by small balloon for the ostium of the side branch would be beneficial.
So we have two opinions now. One opinion is not to dilate the side branch, and one opinion. So what do you think now? Should you take the advice of your assistant, or will you take your own decision routinely in your cath lab? Or how can you evaluate your decision? Depending on the size of the side branch, the length of the lesion, calcified or not, osteo or not, how can you buy two stent versus one stent or to predilate the side branch? Tell us what you are going to do.
So I think the main point is if you want to do provisional stenting, you must avoid absolutely to predilate the side branch. If the side branch is very tight, if the lesion is long, or if you think that the access of the side branch will be very difficult after stenting, that means that you maybe have to stent it also and predilate it. So if you are going to do a two stent strategy, there is no problem for predilatation of the side branch. If it's only a provisional T and you really don't want to predilate the side branch.
Okay.
So we can move on a little bit if you want.
No, another just, opinion. Just last opinion here.
Okay. Thomas, can we use an IVAS to determine the actual size of the vessel? It looks a little bit small.
Yeah. So I think that we have a. I think that we can assess the. You can see the mouse moving on the screen or not?
Yes.
Yes, you can.
Yes. So I think we can assess that the size here is really reliable. And then, according to the Finney law, we see that there is two branch which are smaller than this, which is quite logical. But for sure, as the lesion is very tight, we will, after predilatation, use nitrates and reassess the side of both side branch. And I think that the IVUS could be useful in this case, but with a long lesion like this, and which are chronic for sure, we can have a negative remodeling, and the IVUS can give us, for the distal part, a diameter which be underestimate the real diameter of the artery. So my point in my strategy in this case is to make the predilatation and then do a lot of nitrates as much as the pressure can hold it to assess as best the size of the vessel. And a small tip also for the audience, the Amplatz is a very, very good guiding, but as you know, it can be a little bit aggressive on the ostium of the right. And nowadays, I put my implants, and before doing a full injection, I will advance a little bit my wire in the coronary. So when I do, even if the pressure is good, if I have hydraulic dissection of the right ostium, my wire is already in place. So I think it's a good tip for everyone, when you use Amplatz, and I use Amplatz for almost every angioplasty of the right, is to advance the wire before doing a full injection.
Okay.
So a long lesion, I think I agree with some of you to do a provisional T stenting. I think we can move on a little bit on the live in the box if you agree.
I want to ask, I have a suggestion.
Yeah.
Dr. Thomas Hovas, would you consider going with two wires in the two branches, taking care of the proximal lesion? And then, once you've done the proximal lesion in the proximal RCA, inject the nitrates and do an FFR to see if there is still ischemia or not distally. If there is ischemia, then we could have a plan. But if there's no ischemia, maybe you wouldn't even need to dilate the distal lesion.
Or you can have another view, to see that, that this is a bifurcation.
Because so this is I can so show you this view, and on this view you see that there is not two lesions proximal and distal, but really one long calcified lesion involving the bifurcation. So if there were two lesions, one proximal and one distal, for sure, we can manage to do, and if we think that the second one is an intermediate lesion or non-ischemic lesion, we can treat first the proximal lesion and reassess by FFR the second one. But in this case, I really think that that there is a very long lesion involving the bifurcation. And if you ask me to treat only the proximal part, I don't know where I will stop here, because I will start some maybe from here, and then I don't know to where to stop my angioplasty and stenting. And I think on this view you agree that this lesion, this bifurcation lesion, is really probably ischemic.
Okay, go ahead. We agree about two lesions now.
Okay, so let's move on.
And yeah. The cranial view.
Okay.
But again, when I will have my two wire in place, maybe there will be easier to find a better view.
Yeah, okay. So we had the consensus that provisional is a good option in this case. The big question is in which branch we should go.
Yeah.
I think the longest lesion. So maybe if you can go back to the array of view, we can see.
So here, in favor of stenting, the PDA is it's straightforward, but I think the good option is the other option, is to go for the PLA, because the lesion is longer, and it seems that the lesion is more important in the PLA, and it will, if we want to finish with only one stent, maybe it's a better option.
Okay. So your strategy is to go to the PLA because it will be the most difficult branch.
No, because the lesion, as you can see here, is more important in this branch. If we stent the other branch, the risk of losing it or the need for a second stent will be, I think, in my opinion, will be higher.
Okay. So we'll see the wiring of the second lesion, of the second branch. Yeah. So you have AL1, two run-through wires, and you plan to use, do you have a 48 millimeter stent?
Unfortunately, no.
Okay.
So when using AL1, I think a good tip is to, especially if the ostium is not perfect, when you go with AL1, don't hesitate to engage the wire in the coronary before any injection. In case of hydraulic dissection, it will be easier with the wire in place. Un petit test. Okay, so this is not the right one. Okay, so I will go back for REO.
Yeah, this is a view where you can see the bifurcation.
Un petit test. Okay. Un petit test à nouveau, Estelle, s'il te plaît.
Okay.
Okay, cranial view. So it works the time to have a good position of the wire, quite distal, to have a good support, petit test, at the beginning of the case. Excuse-moi, petit test, s'il te plaît. Okay, so here it's not good. And as you will do some maneuver, there is a risk of moving back the wire is high, so don't hesitate to have a good position, quite distal of the two wires. Okay, so now the two wires are in place. Maybe we can look for a good view of the bifurcation. So this is a RAO. So again, looking for a bigger angle. So not good here. RAO, a little bit cranial. No. So this is a cranial view. Okay, so this is LAO cranial. We can try this because the angle is quite big. Okay, so this is not a bad view.
Thomas, it's a nice demonstration of your technique to separate branches. I think it's very nice. So now...
Okay, so let's do another discussion from here. So I think you saw another tip here that you need to really have your two wire in the main branch and inside branch as far as possible to have a good support. And doing your bifurcation, you will bring and remove balloons, stents several times. So the risk of moving and retrieving accidentally the wire is quite higher than in a normal angioplasty. So don't hesitate to have your wire quite far in the coronary. And then the second tip is when the two wires are in place, it's really easier to have a good view of the bifurcation, and you have to make X-ray and find the bigger angle as possible, between the two wires. So from this view now, have your strategy changed, or are we still agree that the provisional T is a good option? And which branch will you consider to stent?
I think, as we said before, this vessel is undersized, so good pre-dilatation to the main only. And determine the size, and the only provisional standing for the main RCA to the PDA, and just protecting the post-lateral with the wire, and if you need, you can do provisional TAP, but I don't think you need.
So what is the PDA? PDA is the down
one, yes.
And so you advise them to the PDA, yes. Not the post-lateral?
Yes, and because this is the main vessel, and I think it is undersized, and when you do good pre-dilatation and the IVUS, he would be a bigger size than we see.
Any other opinion about which, when to put the stent? You put the stent from the main artery to the posterolateral or PDA?
I think in this view, both are equivalent.
But the PDA is more or less healthy here. It's straight by the wire.
A little bit, yeah.
So I think the stent from the posterolateral.
The posterolateral.
To repair it. to inherit PDA. So who votes for PDA? Who votes for the PDA? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So 50-50. We don't have actual decision. 50-50. So,
okay.
So we need your opinion in decision to putting stent in the main vessel or the bigger vessel to stent down.
So in this case, I think the two branches are quite equivalent. Seems maybe not far in size and not far in myocardial territory. So my concern with this lesion is so here it's a tight lesion proximally, but at the level of the bifurcation, this the lesion towards the PLA is really tight, and I think the lesion is a little bit longer here than here. Here there is probably a lesion which maybe is not really significant, and I think if we stent from here through here, we will have to treat also this part with a balloon on stent. Or if we treat from here through here, I think with a pot and maybe opening of the strut, we can have a good result. So that was my strategy, to treat toward this branch. And I thought at the time that the access to recross the wire will be easier in this branch, and maybe I will not have to treat this part.
For me, I agree with this point. This is my opinion, because I imagine that this is the big artery, because this is the curve and this is very long artery, and this is an early PDA. It's called not a PDA. It's maybe right ventricular branch or an early PDA. So it's not so significant if you leave the PDA. It's a long, maybe you can put the FFR at the end to see if you are going to stent it or not. So, because, so the second question is how to debulk this artery or how to treat predilatation. Just predilatation by semi-compliant, non-compliant, or you do an IVC, there is calcification or not. I don't see calcification here in the angiogram. So if you have a calcification, what's your strategy here?
So I think the feeling of the wire crossing is quite important. So in this case, the wire went quite easily in the lesion. And if a balloon is crossing quite easily, I think we can manage this angioplasty without a special device such as rota or shockwave. But if you see that you are struggling with the wire or with a small balloon, I think we have to reconsider. And the other question also is, in bifurcation, if you want to do a rota, for sure you can't have two wires in the coronary. So it's always a little bit risky or tricky or to let only a wire in this artery and do rota from here to here. And if you lose the branch here during the rota, it could be difficult to retrieve it. So I'm not comfortable, and in bifurcation, to remove a wire, do a rota. So if I can avoid a rota in bifurcation, I prefer.
But when, this is the advantage of the shockwave. This advantage of the shockwave, we can do it with two wires and there is no reflow.
Yes.
Okay. Regarding the stenting here, I heard that from Terry, he asked you about 48 stent. We have a lot of 48 in Egypt here. So if you don't have a 48, so your advice is to do two stents, or to be overlapped stents, starting distally and then go proximally, or you leave a gap in between?
Yes. In many cases, my advice is to go from distal to proximal. Stenting
distally to proximal and not proximal to distal. I think the lesion from ear to ear is above 38. So in this case, I will treat the bifurcation with one stent and then put a second stent just with a minimal overlap proximal.
Okay. Any other suggestion for the panel here? Okay. Good. No other suggestion. Okay. Did you finish?
And always remember that if you need to put two stents, two stents with overlapping in bifurcation, be sure that you will not gel a wire under two stents. Because if you gel a wire under one stent, it's never a problem. You can always remove the wire. If you gel a wire,
emergency case.
No.
Sorry. The distance allowed to be called to leave the gap? Is it between two stents? If you have to. Sometimes here in our circumstances, some of my colleagues said that we have, there's a plaque here, we have to cover the plaque. See, this is an old theory that you do a stenting for even the plaque to cover it. Or because some of the intervention can like goes to Pishar, like the was known as spot stenting. You can spot stenting and leave the gap. Or you do two stents and just touching. Two stents. What is your philosophy in the stenting here? Is to cover the hole, to make it like the jacket, with not leaving any gap, or you can leave some gap?
I think you. It depends when what is a gap. If a gap is under 10 millimeters, I think there is no benefit. To leave a gap because you can have a geographical miss with the predilatation. You will have finally maybe 4, 5, 6 millimeters between the two stents. So in this case, I prefer to have really two joint stents. If there is a gap of 15-20 millimeters, for sure you don't need on the artery is okay, there is no lesion, for sure you can treat with two separated stents and leave a real gap between the two, but it must be quite a long portion of the artery without a lesion.
Are you going to show us at the end the final shot?
So let's move on.
Less important.
Okay.
But I agree. Huh? It's
so we discussed.
Oh yeah.
Before, so I will advance a bit.
And then remove one of the two wires and treat the proximal part.
Towards the PLE.
So this balloon is a semi-compliant?
Yes. Okay. Off.
How much pressure?
So 10 for this first inflation, and I think the diameter is okay. Let's test. Okay. And là, on peut aller à 18.
18.
Okay. What will be your choice? Accord.
So I continue.
Coming here. So this is okay. It went okay. So we need to treat all the lesion. So I think don't hesitate to go a little bit down.
Yeah.
Angio.
Okay.
Okay. So the position is I think okay here. Do you agree?
Yeah.
Okay,
you want two millimeter. Okay,
too late. Okay. Yeah. So how much pressure? 12.
So this is 225.
So we wait, especially in calcified lesion, always wait 30 seconds to be sure that the stent is going well expand. Ma is looking for a different view. Okay. Test. Level. So ACT exchange the wire and then put a stent. Other view. And test.
Okay, so little break again. So you see the stent, and I think that this part is really the most important in every bifurcation. Is in 99% of the case, you have to do a proximal optimization technique because if not, either your stent is too big for the distal part or in many cases is too small for the proximal part. So I think everyone agree now that in bifurcation the pot is mandatory. So here is a pot with a 275 balloon.
Okay. Merci.
It would be proximal.
So I think, Thomas, in this view, you don't see perfectly the ostium of the other bones. I agree. The REO was better for this.
Yeah.
Like this, it was much better.
Yeah, okay. This one is perfect to see.
Okay, off.
So 275, non-compliant.
Yeah. Okay. Well, vas-y.
We do another pot proximally. So I advance a little bit. So with the pot balloon, I also made a better predilatation of the of all the proximal lesions. And this is the
result. Okay, so the result is angiographically not so bad, huh?
Yeah, it's very nice. So here is a result after stent and after pot.
Yes, there is no placebo.
So what do you think? So for sure there is still the proximal part to treat, huh? But it will not be really a problem now.
Ask the panel,
and my question to the audience is what you will do here if you will let like this or opening the strut with a pot side pot or kissing. Okay. So
three options now. To leave the patient like this distally, or to make a pot side pot, or you make kissing.
For me, is to leave the ostium. I think it's okay, not to complicate matters more. Still, we have a proximal lead, and that we should do.
Good. I agree to have the same time.
Three.
Same.
Same.
Yeah. Nagib. No, I still have to do kissing. This is very important.
Dr. Ayman, kissing or leave it, or pot side pot?
I would take another view, reassess it, and can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes.
I would take another view and reassess it relative to pre-PCI. There's a good chance I might leave it alone. I don't usually do this, interfere here, unless I have ECG changes, chest pain, or impairment less than TIMI 3 flow. If I have TIMI 3 flow, no ST changes, no chest pain, I might just leave it, because I would prefer to maintain the circularity of the proximal, of the RCA proximal to the bifurcation. At the end of the day, single stent has a better long-term outcome than two stent. And if I can get away with it, then this is what I would do.
No. Okay, but the question not to put a stent. The question is, number one, to leave it or recross and pot side pot. The third option is 2 FFR for the side branch.
I would take another view and probably leave it.
Turkhelit.
I think we need to do kissing in such and such.
I think in absence of symptoms and ECG changes, I will leave it.
I will try to evaluate the significance of stenosis or the black shift in the side branch first.
Jamal, leave it. FFR. So, you know, there's no answer, no single answer.
Yeah, I see, but I see
we have 30 FFR, 30 30 pot side pot.
I just want to ask, number one, why did we choose to put two stents while we can cover the whole plaque with a one long stent? During pre-dilatation, it seems it's okay that equipments are passing without resistance. So I think we could have used a one long stent, especially that we do not have a great disparity between the size distally and proximally. This is number one. Number two, why did we use a non-compliant balloon after putting the first stent and not waiting till we put the second stent and then we use the non-compliant balloon for the whole length of both stents, covering the overlap and inflating it at high pressure?
Another opinion from Dr. Satiha Kustia.
Yes, this is, if you have a geographical, is at 70% in a side branch, you can leave it with limited load. The second option is do an FFR, not routinely do it.
Thomas, we don't have a single answer. We have different opinions. So
that's the magic of our job. There is no 100%. Everything is changing, and there is no clear answer for everything. So it's very nice. That makes the job interesting. So in this case, I think to the question why put a long stent from the beginning to the distal part, I think still there is a discrepancy between the size of the proximal RCA and the two branches. So that's why we must put a stent according to the distal diameter and then do a pot. And I can't at this point put a second stent here because I still have my gel wire here. So if I put now a second stent here, my this wire will be gel under two stents and it will be very, very difficult to remove it. So to answer on the bifurcation, I have no dogmatic answer also, but my thought at this moment was that this branch was as big as the one I just stent, and I'd rather to have open strut in case of there is a little bit of disease here, even if it's not probably not ischemic. So if there is a atheroma progression and if this lesion should become significant, I will be happier if my strut was open. So I decided to go on and perform a kissing to have a strut open. But for sure, when you do that, you take the risk to have a dissection of the ostium or a result which can be less good than this one, and to take the risk to put a second stent. So fortunately, I will show you the so this is the exchange of the wire. So you see it's always good to towards the side branch
to direct the shape of the wire towards the side branch and then remove slowly.
and drive
the orientation toward the side branch and pull back slowly.
The pullback technique. And at one time it will jump. Okay. You have seen it. Okay.
Okay.
Perfect.
So that's a good technique to go in the distal strut and to be able to project some metal in the side branch. So this is the angeling of the second wire.
But
and I put it back in the PLE. So I will advance a little bit more. So I don't have any
as it comes
also about pot side pot or kissing. I did at a moment a lot of pot side pot and was not so much convinced to the advantage comparing to kissing. And I think also that it's not always easy to do a perfect pot, because you really have to be in a good projection. You really have to put the distal marker of the balloon really at the carina. So it's really you really have to be very precise and very accurate to positioning the balloon for the pot. And so I'm maybe a little bit more comfortable with the kissing, because I think that it can be in most of the case a little bit easier, but it's really my opinion. So in this case I perform a kissing. So you see the second balloon. I generally use for the side branch, not always, but in most of the case, a non-compliant balloon to avoid side branch dissection. And I think it's a good tip also. And you can see the positioning of the two balloons. You don't want to have maybe it's better to have not a too long balloon in the side, and that the side balloon is not going too far in the proximal main branch to avoid a stem deformation with the two balloons at this level.
But in the majority of cases, you have no problem.
So here is the kissing. And I will show you the result after kissing.
Will be to say, don't take a very, very small balloon to make some space and to say.
So. Okay, this is your angio.
So let's do an angio now. Okay. So
So I will show you the angio, the final image on the bifurcation, which is this. This one. So I think we discussed before that the FFR can be a good option to know if we leave it like it or not. So what do you think of the result on the bifurcation?
The panels, who agree to leave it or who agree to do FFR? And to leave it, and I leave it. I'm leave it. Get it FFR. Get it FFR. We have only okay. We have three doctors out of maybe seven for the panelists agree to leave it, and three agree about the FFR. The question okay. is so the size of the artery, depending the size of the artery. Is crucial to depend on what to do FFR or not, or the percentage of narrowing left after pot side pot or kissing. Because this is, we don't have evidence of ischemia now, just pain, no ECG changes, patients okay, TV, it looks like 30% lesion. So we are going to do the FFR. You hear me?
Yes. So at this point, I decide to leave it like it and to assess a few months later by stress MRI if there was a residual ischemia. So I didn't perform any more things on the bifurcation. And I finished the case with removing one of the two wires and stent the proximal part.
There's another suggestion here, Dr. Stia. Yes.
No, I know. I mean, if you don't use an IFFR or IFFR, should be done before the dilatation. Now it's dilated. And you have to accept it angiographically.
Okay. The idea here is to FFR before dilatation, not after dilatation. Okay.
Yes, but that means that you have to treat the proximal part of the artery first and to stent it also.
Yeah.
And so you have to remove to remove one of the wires. So I think it's implicating
You can put a new wire. A third wire in the side branch, and then remove the jailed wire, and then stent proximal part, and then at the end, look for the FFR or IFFR, and see what's going. Maybe both side, both, or you can leave it.
So after kissing?
No. Third wire at the beginning, just before the proximal stenting. For third wire side branch, remove the jailed wire. Now you are ready for either do FFR, or to put a proximal stent and then FFR for the distal one.
That's the things we discussed a little bit before, that to leave it like this or do an FFR. It's also an option, but as I told you, I was more comfortable to have the strut open in all case for okay. This patient, as a branch is as big as the one.
Okay, Thomas, can you show us the last shot because they are out of time, and then we are looking for the other.
This is the last shot, and you see the result is quite acceptable.
No, show us the lateral view to the ostium. Here is this an overlap of the two branches. Do you have a picture? Yes, okay, here.
So this is the final picture, and you see there is some disease, but the result is okay with only one stent, a pot and a kissing.
Dr. Khaled Chokri here needs another stent, I think. No.
There is long overlap between the two stents. You prefer this? You mean that, or this is only for... the length of the availability of the lenses of that sense.
The amount of overlap.
Sorry?
In this case, how much the amount of overlap between the two stents is 2 millimeters?
It's the minimal overlap. If I can, I put the stent just side by side with no overlap. And if not, I will choose to have one millimeter of overlap, two max. The less is the better. Talking about overlap.
Okay, thank you very very much, Thomas, for this excellent case for how to do a bifurcation stenting or just ballooning, and then how to deal with the different techniques. Thank you very very much. Looking for the for you maybe the. Today for the CTO. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.